Welcome, ye faithful. Welcome all who wish to learn the ways of the hellish court and hear the gospel of the Lady Marie. Come in, listen to my sermon, and treasure these words within your heart and soul. Prepare the mind and heart to receive my words, for whilst it will take some time to comprehend the truth, great will be the reward, as it contains the keys to everlasting joy and salvation. I shall bequeath unto you knowledge of all things that govern and inform the clashing of swords, the noble strife between us, the enlightened fighters in the duel. I dedicate the sermon to you, O highest lady of purple and black, you with slender blade and deadly point, daughter of lilies with the feathered cap. May you grant me the winged words to spread your truth, enlightenment, but furthermost to instill in all who will listen the righteous fear of your keen eyes that see even the slightest misstep in your opponent and punish him with steely point in a heartbeat. So, have you not heard of these teachings? Then rejoice, for they shall surely deliver you from all your troubles. Have you heard them and accepted the Lady of Slender Blade as your true goddess? Then I bless you. Listen and be strengthened in your faith by my testimony. For all who have heard the gospel and yet rejected them, to you I promise the eternal torture by the steely pointed rapiers of the true believers, the flock of righteous fighters unified under the heavenly flag of Marie. Repent, repent now, I tell you. Throw down your crooked blades, your unwieldy weapons, and embrace the elegance of the complex-hilted blade that pierces all. Or be yourself cast into eternal strife and damnation by the faithful. Before I begin, however, I have to offer one bit of explanation to this by sermon, for it is but the first in a series of sermon I will dedicate to all aspects of Our Lady and the intricacies that arise in the dueling arena. This part of my speeches will be on the basics of the duel, before I delve into a deeper description of her, our own lady, her mode of fighting, as well as her contemptible adversaries in later parts. Now then, hearken to my words and do not miss a syllable, for this is the eternal truth, and all other wisdom pales in comparison to the mysteries of our faith. Gifted by the inscrutable creator, the prime mover, whose ways are beyond our mortal understanding and knowledge, we have received the greatest gift of all, the spiritual battlegrounds of the hellish court, where we are given the possibility to fight, to strive with one another, and to achieve excellence in the duel, as well as in patience and determination. Great as this gift is, yet there still remain dark temptations put in place to deceive the weak of spirit and test the faith of the good of heart. For in this sacred space, once one has selected a mode of challenge, it seems as though one were greeted by a selection of various fighters arrayed before one's eyes, all waiting to be chosen. This, however, is an illusion, a fantasy, cast by the weakness of our mind and the innate depravity of the human soul. While at first it may seem as though one might pick any of these personages, check this impulse immediately. Take your hands off your means of control and cast out these blasphemous thoughts. Rid yourself of the images before you. Rid yourself of the temptation that the splendor of Yashik's garments offers. Deny the rugged appeal of Barabash. Squish the lust you feel at the sight of Isabella's long and mighty blade. Ignore the bright colors of Laszlo and burn the image of Gideon's ample thighs. There shall be but one picture in your mind. One figure you shall worship. Thus, move the arrow of conviction quickly over to the black and violet lady, lest it be sullied by the essence of the dark spirits that haunt the rest of your screen. Do so, and you shall become ascendant. Deny her and be damned. But even if you have sinned thusly against our goddess, you still may be forgiven. Choose her from now on. Be penitent and give up your life to her, or suffer your rightful fate. Once you have passed this test of spirit, you may select for your opponent, or will be thrown into strife with a random adversary, if survival is your chosen mode. Beware that fighting against one of the demons is only advised for believers of greater faith. If you wish to keep yourself especially pure from corruption, choose Marie as your opponent, and remain aloof from lowly forms of being.
Thence, you will in some modes be granted the opportunity of selecting a staging ground for the duel. Here you may choose freely, but make sure to reflect on the lady's virtues and eternal truth in all your actions. Pray to her ceaselessly and find answers to all things in your devotion to her. Thence you are set into the place of bloodshed, the hallowed grounds where to conduct your feud to the inevitable conclusion. The bout will commence after a greeting by both parties involved, and quick as the lightning, the opponents will spring into action, moving hither and thither on nimble feet, as this is an ability shared amongst all the beings, from basest to the most holy. While what follows are, to most obvious facts, it is nonetheless important to comprehend them fully and to use them intentionally. Now then, let us discuss all modes of movement quickly, so you may learn the basics and be able to implement them correctly. Firstly, for axes of movement there are 8, 4 in the cardinal directions, which are towards the foe, to intimidate and wound, away from the enemy to avoid and confound, as well as in clockwise direction and its counterpart. These, to dodge sharp blades and circumvent defenses put up against your steel. Then, still 4 lie in between the major ones, to be used as intermediaries between the greaters. By a quick double tap of the directional keys, the character will perform a dash in the indicated direction. Use this to disengage more quickly, close the distance faster, or rush around your foe at speed. To harm the other, fighters may use strikes from 4 angles corresponding to the 4 keys bound to them, 2 high and 2 low, one of each left and the other one to the right. How each attack is formed and executed is now the union between current movement and attack angle. The fighters will block attacks without needing a prompt to do so. This is, however, not a perfect defense. Strikes can slip through a guard, feints may throw off a fighter's defenses, or a strong blow might harm even when the opponent interposes his steel. Also, an alternate stance can be entered with the proper key. Here, different attacks are then possible, as is the option of pushing your foe's blade with your own. Let me quickly mention 3 other modes of interacting with the enemy. There are the strike or kick, which is automatically performed in very close quarters to stun the opponent. The blade push, unsurprisingly used to push on the other's blade with your bare hand to create an opening. And finally, grappling, which is as of yet restricted to 1 grab in close quarters, which the other party may escape by quickly retreating. Lastly, let me warn all that swinging your sword or parrying is not without consequence. For each character has but a finite resource of stamina he may spend at any one time. This replenishes with a quick rest, but still is not infinite in the moment. Should it run out completely, you will not be able to defend yourself and thus become an easy target for an advancing foe. Beware that your pool of strength is permanently reduced upon suffering injury, and an injury to the leg might on top of that restrict your movement by the pain inflicted. Even if you are, as of yet, inexperienced, do not become disheartened by the prospect of learning a completely new art. For now, try to grasp as best you can the following 3 concepts. These will guide you through your spiritual journey in the arena of steel. The first principle is that of distance. The distance between the adversary can be broken down to the 3 measures. In the furthest, you are safe, for the opponent cannot harm you even if he lunges. Both you and your opponent are completely safe in this measure. One or both of the parties will need to close the distance to reach the second measure. Here, an attack can be started by one of the fighters that reaches the enemy with a single step or a lunge forward. This distance is different for each individual character, and there are ever fewer attacks that have the sufficient reach with the opponents further apart, thus limiting the ways in which the enemy may threaten you. Finally, in the third measure, you may strike at one another without taking a step. Here, strike down your opponent quickly, or retreat in haste, lest you fall beneath the cold steel.
Thus, it is imperative for a duelist to ingrain in himself the distances from which his strikes will land true, same for his opponent's attacks.
As the second principle, we conceive motion. 'Tis justly said, the one who moves is alive, and the one who stands still is dead. For in standing still, you give your opponent the chance to dictate the moment of your encounter. Likewise, your movement should not be predictable to the adversary. Do not let your opponent decide the time to strike, but keep this in your own hand. The final great principle is that of tempo or timing. You can surprise your opponent with a quick attack he cannot react quickly enough to, or can wait for an opponent to strike and miss or have their blow blocked and then strike yourself quickly. These are but simple options and must be selected for depending on the situation and your opponent. Yet, there is a third way, in which you strike in time with your opponent, in a manner giving you an advantage. Achieving this consistently is very difficult, as it requires you to anticipate your opponent's actions. So, while trying to surprise your opponent or to wait for an opening are simpler to be sure, the opponent will learn your standard responses and counter them with a follow-up or a different attack in time with your own. Binding all the principles together, we find a higher ideal that may not be quantified or simply taught as the others. This is to surprise the enemy and be unable to be predicted yourself. Use all the principles in deceiving the enemy. Move in ways that lead him to strike out of measure and punish his mistakes immediately. To this end, you have the ability to feint many attacks by quickly retreating. Master your own movement to know what it reveals about your intentions, and then read your opponent to find his predictable patterns. Do this and you will emerge victorious. You can learn these principles even without knowing the minutiae of the fighters, simply by experience and dedication. Try to dictate the moment of engagement and let your opponent's strikes fall short by nimble movement, while yourself always striking true by keen-eyed measure of the space between you as well as proper timing. Try to remember these wisdoms, for the person who masters them all will be a god amongst duelists. Let me now finish this part of my sermons. Feel free to contradict me on any statement. If you dare, I shall defend myself with the zeal of a man easy at heart by his conviction in the right faith. And should I be proven to be incorrect, I must accept this as punishment for failing in my devotion to the Lady Marie. Let me bring warning to all of you who wish to simply ignore these directives of the fleet-footed Marie. Divine revelation has blessed us with the knowledge of her supremacy and given us the guiding lines towards excellence. Go now, in the name of Our Lady with the Shining Hilt, return to this place of worship, soon to receive further instructions. Farewell. Praise the Lady's name and remain faithful to her ways, for blessed are those who follow the narrow path of her keen-pointed blade.